That's coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show.
Here tonight is a special man.
Nigga, with an A on the end. Well, I think I can now. Isn't that the point? Because it's not racist. That's the point. I could be talking about a male. I could be a Chinese male. A guy at the laundromat.
Beloved by millions of Americans.
How many of you guys, in your own experience with women, have learned that no means yes if you know how to spot it?
Meanwhile, Al Sharpton goes out the front door. Yes, I spoke a little Negro dialect there. I can do that when I want to. In and out the front door.
He is the greatest fighter and winner that you
are. Yo, peace, world. It's Pat Kimon Freeman, Angry Black Man in Therapy, one half of We Act Radio, broadcasting on the radical side of Martin King Avenue, the other better nation's capital, the foothill, the Cedar Hill, the line of Anacostia, the Frederick Douglass home, the first black man to buy a house in Anacostia. And he had to get a white man to do it for him. He had to have a beard. So it hasn't much changed in the nation's capital. We see Confederate flags flying in the nation's capital. We live in exciting times. Many of us are familiar with Martin Luther King's last speech, but we're not as familiar with his next to the last speech, which was entitled Remaining Awake During a Great Revolution. It was delivered right here in Washington, D.C., March 31st, 1968. He went on to say that all too often people live in periods of great social change, and yet they fail to develop the new attitudes, the new ideas, the new mental responses that the new situation demands. They end up sleeping through a revolution. And so hence comes the phrase, stay woke. And that was delivered to me directly from the mouths of Bob or Dick Gregory, stay woke. And then we have to say that it's an honor to be here today with a man that has been woke his entire adult life and has been putting action behind those words. And we could not let this day go unacknowledged. February 24th is the born day of Rock Newman. And he has been a towering figure in DC cultural landscape for decades. He was a Howard University Baseball Hall of Famer, or is rather, Howard University Baseball Hall of Fame. And he took Riddick Bowe to the heavyweight championship in 1992. People didn't believe he could do that. He took humanitarian aid to Somalia. People didn't think he could do that. He took his black ass to South Africa when he was fighting apartheid and had the pleasure of spending 3 days with Nelson Mandela, otherwise known to the world as Madiba. And that was something that I'm sure he never thought would happen as well. So joining us today is the fact that Rock Newman, who is partially responsible for putting We Act Radio on the map, and he took his show to PBS, WHUT-TV, and has been very successful. He had spoken to so many people, and some of them we're gonna share with you here today. And I wanted to make sure that we give him his flowers while he can smell them. And join us is Rock Newman, and on his birthday, and he said that he's turning 69 today, and he's dedicating it to the legacy of Fred Hampton, who was neutralized by the United States government in 69. Rock Newman, welcome back to We Act Radio, brother.
Man, it's always good to be home. You know, there's an adage that says you can never go home again. Well, that's not true. because here I am. And I am genuinely thankful and humbled that you guys took the time to even think about me today. And, you know, as you described the show and We Act Radio being there on Martin Luther King Avenue, I can tell you that as I looked for a home for my show, to be able to have residents at We Act Radio right there on Martin Luther King Avenue, it gave me a sense of pride. It gave me a sense, a further sense of purpose. And it just was a fit, man. I referred to We Act Radio as a little station that could. And now after all of your successes, I have to say We Act Radio is a little station that did, continues to keep on doing. In line with your theme, the first thing I ever heard out of your mouth was, Rock Newman, you want to make some money, you want to make a difference, or you want to do something. And I said all of the above.
Yeah.
So, man, thank you. Thank you very much for for doing this today. And before I finish, you see this this distinguished gentleman on the screen here, my dear brother, Avis. There are many people who supported me in this enterprise, and too many to name, but Avis has been with me from the very beginning and has been really the backbone of our growing our, for example, our YouTube subscriber list now is beyond 160,000. And we like to think the content has something to do with that, but Avis is adroit steering of our social media and promotion has really helped us. So thank you, Kamon. And I wanted to say at the outset a very public thank you to Avis and all others who supported the Rock Newman Show over these last 8 years.
And with that, we'll pass it to Avis, who has been an instrumental figure at We Act Radio and also went on the whole distance with the Rock Newman Show as a co-producer. So welcome back to We Act Radio, Brother Avis. You normally behind the scenes, but now you're in the hot seat, brother. Welcome.
Yes, sir. It's a pleasure to be back. I started at We Act Radio with you. And I remember the very first video, the very first time that we got together, and you told me you was going to do the interview with Rock Newman. I've been in D.C. area since the 80s. So when when you said that, you know, I was kind of like, wow, I was always wanting to meet Rock, because Rock was always, you know, he was a well-known and popular figure, always busy, you know, and doing things in the D.C. area. So that very first interview, I was there also. And then, so I got to thank We Act Radio for making that connection, you know, introducing me to Rock. But throughout that time, I remember Rock was talking about, hey, I want to do this radio show. And brother, you know, you want to be in on, you know, I want you to be in it, on it with me. So that was, you know, that was an honor right there, you know. And throughout that, it's just been an extraordinary experience. I mean, I'm a kid from Philly, came here to DC in the 80s, you know, went to We Act Radio, and through Mr. Newman, I mean, I've met so many people, and many of his friends are my friends now. And so the experiences that I've had with him and through this journey, through the show, was just, I mean, I just can't thank him enough. You know, I mean, that's real family when we talk about Rock Newman.
Yeah, yeah. And he doesn't just, you know, talk the talk, he walks the walk. We're going to get into some of the clips, some of the highlights over the years of the Rock Newman Show. But before we do, for those who still aren't familiar with this DC legend in his own time, Rock, tell us something about you, because I always wanted to point out to my favorite story. And it's when you was in the midst of negotiating one of those lucrative HBO deals. In fact, you was credited with one of the most lucrative deals. So talk about that, but then tell about that story about the executive that pulled you aside. I don't know if you can run with those, please, and share with our audience.
Yeah, so this was late This was late 1992. Riddick Bowe had won the heavyweight championship on November the 13th, 1992. And we had been able to maneuver and to position Riddick to be in a position to fight for the heavyweight championship without being obligated to a TV network or a casino. And which are normally the two things that, you know, you get locked in on when you start, when you get towards the big time. Well, in part because of corporate arrogance and a disbelief that Bowe could become the heavyweight champion. They didn't believe in him, and they did not, certainly did not believe in me. You know, they just thought that, you know, it would never happen that he would become the heavyweight champion. So we slipped through the cracks and didn't have a commitment to, as I said, a casino or a television network. The two big ones at the time were HBO and Showtime. And we also we were able to position Fox Television, who was really trying to get a big halftime event of the Super Bowl to counter program against Michael Jackson. So I kind of was able to pit all three sides against the other because we were a free agent. And so when we were sitting there at HBO, which had already, you know, gone above and beyond the others, I was looking for a package that was a minimum of $100 million all in terms of for a six fight deal at the time, which included, television revenue and live site revenue. And when we got up to about $65 million sitting there at the table, I was way unimpressed. I was like, this is not what I want. Here's what I want. And here's why we should get it. We are bringing value that I am going to demand that whoever we sign a contract with meets the value that we bring. And so Dan Duke, who was an experienced promoter, who had been Holyfield's promoter, who, in order to get the Holyfield fight for gold, ahead of Lennox Lewis, ahead of Tommy Morrison, ahead of others, I gave him a small financial interest in Bowe's, potentially in Bowe's fights going beyond. And he was sitting at the table. He had no decision-making ability whatsoever, but he was sitting there. And so he put his hands up like this. He said, time out. And it's about eight of us around the table. He said, time out. And he said, can I talk to you outside? So we went outside the room and he says, Rock, you're going to blow this deal. $65 million is more money than you ever dreamed of. And I was stunned by that statement. You know, in this time of social unrest, we talk about white supremacy. And it hit me right at that moment, is who is this gentleman that can think that thinks he can prescribe for me what my dreams are? Tell me I'm an idiot. Tell me that I'm not sophisticated. Tell me a whole bunch of things to be your opinion. But God damn it, don't tell me what my dreams can be. And so after a few choice words, I walked back in and sat down at the table. And I'm going to tell you, it was a long, tough negotiation. But somewhere around midnight that night, we left out of that room with a $100 million deal for Riddick Bowe. And the headlines in the newspapers the next day accurately described that it's the largest individual package for a single athlete in the history of sports. So, man, you know, the overwhelming takeaway from that I tell that story because I want to infuse folks that might be in the sound of my voice, whoever they are. Dream big. Never let anyone prescribe your dream for you. You know, it comes under the category of Jesse Jackson's quotes of, you know, if I can believe it and see it, I can achieve it and all of that. But believe in yourself and believe in your dreams.
That is that emotional intelligence is more important than IQ. And that's the lesson I gathered from that. Because, I mean, they was trying to create the illusion of control. Because this is basically, you know, the moral equivalent of war when you're negotiating. And they wanted you to learn humility. But rather, you taught them resilience.
I had put in 4 years of nonstop commitment and work, leaving no stone unturned, Kimon. It was when the week of the fight, as much of an intense person as I was during that time, and some people say still, Dan Duva's dad one time, he chimed in and said, Rock Newman is so intense, he makes coffee nervous. but man, I was committed. My head was down for 4 straight years. I was absolutely committed to this mission. And I had done everything human that I have within me to make this dream come true. Now it was time for Riddick Bowe to get in the ring. But the satisfaction that I had before the fight was dedicating myself to doing the absolute best that I could. And I want to say that, you know, there's something there. And so win or lose, I knew I had done the best that I could do. And, you know, we were blessed with that victory and then blessed, to your point, of knowing that I now have the power, I have the prize here, which means I have the power. And so many times in my observation through the years, I had seen people have the power and not use it. I would be damned if that was going to be me. We had what they desperately wanted. They were embarrassed. Whoever didn't get this deal was going to be humiliated, and I made them pay.
Yes, you did. Yes, you did. And for those who don't know, Rock at his height, when the spotlight hit him, he blacking up. You know, he's like he did a Beyonce. You know, he got black earth. You know, he stayed an African god. You know, this was back when Spike Lee couldn't get money for Malcolm X. So, you know, Black Lives Matter was not out.
Hey, come on, I'll tell you what, man. There are a couple of antidotes along the way there, and that is, you know, when we were close to getting to the top was the time when Marion Barry was suffering his most humiliating situation. And, you know, was ended up going to jail. And, you know, when he got released, you know, and part of what I was doing was, you know, providing a respite for him. So he came to training camp with us. He hung out with us. I remember one of the fights, I wanted to make sure that Marion was right there at ringside. So post victory, he could get in the ring. And the world would see this black man who had fallen has now got up in the ring and getting ready to fight some more. None of that imagery was lost on me, the importance of it. So, and I had people, friends, family, associates that I was dealing with in the business to say to me, man, you're getting ready to, I mean, you're not there. You're not at the top yet. You, this is this image here of this man who got caught on tape smoking crack cocaine is going to damage your reputation. It's going to damage what you're trying to accomplish. And, you know, I mean, I listened, but I wasn't the call I was cut from. You know, that was my friend. He had become my friend, you know. And, of course, there's a success story, you know, there with Marion also, who came back from the politically dead to become mayor once again. So it's been a, it's right. been a crazy but wonderful journey.
Yeah, and while we're on the subject of Marion Barry, and we hope that that this second film is going to come out, hopefully with Eddie Murphy portraying him in a biopic. But there's a great film already on Marion Barry, The Nine Lives of Marion Barry. And they talk about how he was the driving engine behind the Million Man March, because it couldn't have happened in any other city without the support that it received from Marion Barry's last administration. So I just want to put that in historical context as well.
Well, that is very fair. You know, in getting Marion back into the mayor's office, it really took a yeoman's effort. I was, you know, more than happy to play what's been identified, you know, as a significant role in doing so. I became the chairperson of his transition team when he came back into office. So I worked very closely with Marion as the Million Man March was approaching. And I can tell you what you just said is absolutely true. I don't think anywhere else in this country could it have happened. And Marion put his shoulder to the wheel, and the minister credited him both privately and publicly with being invaluable to the Million Man March happening. You know, so many times folks who not from DC don't understand, ask the question, why is he so beloved? We don't have time in the next 2 weeks to talk about why he's so beloved, man. It's a DC thing, and a whole lot of other people just don't understand.
There it is. All right, so having said all of that, what brought you to the idea and the concept of heading your own program, The Rock Newman Show?
So from 2006 to 2010, I spent maybe 80% of my time in Bermuda. My good friend, Howard University graduate, Dr. Ewart Brown, had become premier of the country. So, you know, I was on that little island, and it was a microcosm of the racism that exists in the United States. But man, it was like, you could see it all the time. And he was an unapologetic Black man also. And these little islands in the Caribbean, which Bermudians will quickly tell you, Bermuda is not, Bermuda's in the Atlantic. But they have typically had a loyalty to the crown in England. And many of them, even if you took a vote today, they don't want to be self-sufficient. They don't want to be independent. They want to continue to suck the tit of the queen. And Ewart Brown and a few others was not about that same mentality. So he came in as an unapologetic Black man, and the racist newspaper there, the Royal Gazette, the Bermuda Sun, and every other entity, they tried to slay him every day. It was an ugly onslaught of just white supremacists trying to tear down a Black man who dared to try to liberate his people and be strong for his people. Now I'm seeing that. And then on the other hand, I'm seeing, you know, the general news from around, from the country. And somewhere in the midst there, it occurred to me just how blatantly wrong the story and the narrative of Black people had been portrayed forever and was continuing to happen. So, you know, I lived through that further epiphany. And I saw my wife and I were living in Las Vegas at the time. And a year or so later, we plan on moving back to DC. And it's like, okay, I'm retired. I'm retired of sorts. I'm not committed to any particular undertaking or enterprise. What do I want to do when I get back to DC? And I did an interview with Ricky Clemons, who had a show at the time that he would do on WHUR radio. And it was primarily focused on sports. But I went in the studio and it was just the two of us. I think I did a 90-minute interview. When I came out of that interview and was walking down the hall, I knew that what I wanted to do was to have a voice and to try from my little place, my little corner of the world, to try to have an impact on the narrative of how Black folks were portrayed. When I thought about BET and thought about how I got to tell this part too, because I had a good friend of mine who went to the University of Maryland, a young gentleman that I was mentoring, and he married a Chinese lady. Long story short, I'll cut through it. He married a Chinese lady. After a couple of months, after they got married, her father took ill in China. She had to go run the business. He was a joyful brother. He is not the type that's a revolutionary. He's an artist. He's a photographer. He's a peace-loving brother. But he went to China to live with her after a couple of months that she was there. They couldn't take it anymore. And when he would walk down the street sometime, folks would walk on the other side of the street. There would be people that would spit on the sidewalk. Now, I found this out because one day I asked him, I said, man, since your attitude has changed, what's wrong? What's going on? And he started to tell me about the degradation that he was feeling and the racism that he was experiencing in China. And part of that racism was as a result of the narrative that has been told. And BET was very guilty of perpetuating that narrative when they got folks up there shaking all they, you know, what they're ultimately doing is shaking their ass and talking about music, bitches and hoes and all the rest. And in part, the rest of the world was seeing us that way. So I was like, man, I want to do something about that. How can I do that? I need a platform where my voice can be heard. But more importantly, I can showcase Black folks doing things and highlight the best of who we are. So when I started my show, one of the things I think they tell you in communication school, if you don't have a show, don't have an agenda, just be strictly objective. I had an agenda. And my agenda was to show the best of Blackness. And I'm proud to say that I think that, you know, we've done a pretty good job of showcasing who we are, and it's far from bitches and hoes. It's Don Peoples, who's the leading real estate developer. It's Kathy Hughes, who has, you know, a Radio One. It's Minister Farrakhan of the Nation of Islam. It's Dick Gregory. It's Tony Brown. It's so many who are making a positive difference in our lives that so often get overlooked because the agenda from that other side is to continue to downplay who we are and to attempt to take away what is our greatness. Because if we take away that greatness and the generations behind us are looking up and all they're seeing on the news is about Black on Black murder and this crap music and videos that are showed, there's a, you know, it kills vision to be great. And I wanted to try to have an impact on that. And I still do.
And indeed you have, you know, as we said before, until the lions have their own historians, the tales of the hunt will continue to glorify the hunter. And we honor you here today for telling the lion's story. And as you said, you know, we opened the show with a clip from Rush Limbaugh, you know, in the words of Amon Maidley, you know, I was taught by my mother to speak good of the dead. He dead. Good. So he clearly had an agenda. And I think that your show was the perfect clapback to that agenda. His reign of racist ignorance, you was the sunshine of conscience and inspiring information. I even referred to you before as the Black Charlie Rose. But then I was like, of course, Charlie went down. But even before then, I was like, that's a white supremacist thought. Why am I using Charlie Rose as the barometer?
Sure.
You know, how are you Black Charlie Rose? Would I say that you the Black the Black Babe Ruth? No, yeah. Babe Ruth was the white Josh Gibson.
Yeah.
We really have to rewire. I think your program helped us start to rewire our thinking, and I hope some people are getting some of that now. So we're gonna get into some of the rewiring that your program had accomplished. We're going to start it off with an artist, David Banner. Will you talk to him about lyrics? Let's go to it then.
Is the first thing Obama did when he got in office was he went and told Black men to go raise their children. And I was like, but dude, you're not talking about what happened to us to make us be that way. You didn't talk about slavery. You didn't put any of that ownership on anybody else. And it's the same thing with white people. They always pointing fingers. And you knew that you've been redlining our communities. As a matter of fact, you knew what the ghetto was. The ghetto was an experiment, literally. And I learned this in the Holocaust Museum here in DC, that the ghetto was actually an experiment that the Nazis did to Jewish people, where they started off on animals. They put animals in an enclosed situation, gave them limited resources, and they saw that those animals ripped each other apart. Then they used it on the Jewish people, and it worked. And America is so ego-driven that they still call it the ghetto. So you know what ghettos do to people. Then you turn around and ask us, why do we treat each other the way that we do? But see, because we don't read, because we're so emotional, it perpetually keeps happening all the time.
And that was David Banner. You want me to rap about roses and plant some. All right. Avis, give us a David Banner story, brother.
Well, let's talk about the show. When me and Rock, you know, Rock and I myself talked about the show, and Rock had his mission. I mean, we all know how Rock is well established. I mean, his influence and his associations are just so vast, you know. And one of the aims for the show was to be unapologetically Black and to make the perfect marriage in a sort of a passing of the torch. And in the new people, the people in the new revolutionaries and the ones that were all, you know, that's well known and that's out there. And, you know, and that I kind of wanted to go back to when we talked about Mayor for Life, you know, Marion Barry. And I think it was Ozzie, who did the eulogy for Malcolm X?
Ozzie Davis.
And they said, did you ever walk?
And Martin Luther King.
You know, and he said, you know, and did you ever talk with Brother Malcolm? And those things are critical when you talk about these personalities, because these men are, you know, you can't believe the tremendous amount of stress and pressure that these men be under to achieve the things they achieved. And, you know, through the Rock Newman Show, I've got a chance to walk with a lot of these people, with Mayor for Life, Marion Barry, and just to talk with him and just to see how brilliant of a person he is and kind and nice and you know, and walk with the minister and, you know, and our brother Dick Gregory, you know what I mean? You know, my thing is if you ain't been cussed out by Dick Gregory, you don't know Dick Gregory. You know what I mean? So, So that's how I first met him, you know. But through that, I understood he was just trying to get me to, you know, get prepare me for this wealth of information that that he you know, through the talks with him, that, you know, just the conversations and just with Rock, walk with Brother Rock. I mean, I can go on and on. We had to make this a 6-hour video just to go through the conversations with Rock and just talking about, you know, the things that in his experiences, is it, you know. So with David Banner, he was one of the first that we was like, hey, you know, this brother, and he, you know, he had a lot of profound things to say, and we wanted to support him. And so, you know, Rock said, hey, let's get him, put him on the show. And he's one of many others, Tariq Nasheed, who's been on the show several times, you know.
Oh, go ahead. Yeah, I'm sorry, but you just really strike something. And come on, you know, as we talk about these various people we have on, keep in mind, our show was broadcast on PBS. So sure. It is unmistakable that there was always attention, you know, not sit at attention, but there was a tension in terms of who we wanted to book, what their positions were, juxtaposed to what is typically more the docile PBS program. I can tell you, I never let that sway me from getting the voices that I thought our people needed to hear. I always envisioned that there would be a mother and a father, a mother and a child. But always I've envisioned that some young 12-year-old was sitting out there and might look at what we were doing and hear something that would inspire them to their own greatness. That, to me, was my standard, not what a university program, WHUT, I did it there, not what a university might necessarily want, or not what a PBS conglomerate folks might want, but what would best serve that 12-year-old kid. Could I give him a kernel of hope to become great? And so many of the folks that we had on, I think, fit that role perfectly.
And speaking of tension, you had Brother Minister on not once, but twice, Brother Faircom on. And there was always tension whenever Furcon's name comes up. And one of the things that I tell people all the time, Madiba, Nelson Mandela, says that the enemies of the West are not ours. They tried to tell him who his friends were, you know.
Yeah.
He embraced Gaddafi, he embraced Fidel Castro. And the West tried to tell him who his friends are. And I think that one of our problems is that if we're not able to say clearly who our friends are and who our enemies are, then we're always going to have problems. Because we have seen what, like, the Judas and the Black Messiah, Fred Hampton assassination, was FBI and Chicago police coordination. J. Edgar Hoover's FBI was involved in COINTELPRO and the neutralizing of Black leaders. And we just now had the FBI confirm that they also were behind Malcolm X assassination. But yet and still, the FBI is a respectable institution. Yet and still, an agent of that institution will be welcome in these media outlets as an authority on these things. But then they want to shun Farrakhan, who hasn't killed anybody, you know? Yeah. So I think that's part of white supremacy, because we want to mute those voices. And, you know, as I said before, you know, I don't agree with everything my mother says. But that does not mean that I should not have love and respect for her. And so we want to talk about some of that tension in Farrakhan. He talks about Obama in here. Let's go to that now to get some of this tension. And Farrakhan is one of his appearances on the Rock Newman Show.
The issue of Louis Farrakhan. And he denounced you. The personal reflection I'm talking about, as you sit there and hear this, he attended the Million Man March. I happen to be aware through some extensive research that there may have been a point in time that he sought some of your counsel. He denounced you before the world, and that made you feel how?
There's always a bigger picture. When we look in the mirror of life and we only see ourselves, we're vain. And vanity means you live in yourself for yourself, and when you die, who the hell cares? When I looked in the mirror, I always tried to see what is the bigger picture. Barack Obama was the bigger picture. If he did not denounce me under the prodding of Mrs. Clinton, yes, who's getting hers now, mm-hmm, he would never have been president, because the powerful Jewish lobby, Zionist lobby in America, would not have backed him had he not denounced me. So I kept my quiet, and I told people around me, don't even address it. Get him where he wants to go. Get him where Black America wants him to go. Get him where young Americans, Black, white, and brown, want to see him go. And we did that. I am who I am, and his denunciation of me didn't hurt me. But it said that you do what you have to do to go where you have to or want to go, and there's a lot of bodies left around.
I happen to think that what you just said is very true in terms of, had he not denounced you, he could not have ascended to the White House. So let me ask you, and there are others, profound scholars, who believe that same thing. So what is it about Louis Farrakhan that those who would have forced that denunciation are concerned about, that they would put their political capital, their money, their energy and time to extract that denunciation? What do you think that is about you and your message, says about you and your message?
They make me a litmus test for any Black person who wants to rise in the political, economic, social, religious, and educational context of America. When white people talk to Black people who want to rise, invariably sometimes my name will come up. What do you think of Farrakhan? And they have to be prepared to give an answer that satisfies those who control.
There was that tension we was talking about. Rock, we want to get some of these other clips in, but I got to let you say something about this one. Obama, you know, Farrakhan was on Obama. What's your thought?
Yeah, so when I invited the minister to come on, I knew, you know, what kind of fire there would be, you know, and so I have told you how much I want the message to get out from the greatness of our people and the ones who communicate our greatness the best. I want it to have. But the minister, it has always been controversy surrounding the minister. So what I did was I reached out to the group, Gary, what was his name? The gentleman who was of the Leadership Institute in Atlanta.
Southern Poverty. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, Southern Poverty Senator, say, hey, why don't you come on and have a conversation? And I asked the minister, I said, look, here's what I'm gonna make that invitation. And he was like, I don't have any problem, with doing it. I don't think they'll come on. And he didn't want to come on, I can't remember his name, Pollock. His name is Pollock, I think. But he didn't come on while the minister was there, but he came on and he had his statement. So I knew unquestionably, you know, there was going to be a controversy surrounding that. But it's like, man, you know, that was 2013. It was almost 20 years earlier. This man is probably the single person in the country who could have given that clarion call to ask a million men to come to Washington, D.C. for a day of atonement. And way more than a million showed up. And again, to show you how these white supremacists tried to change history on the spot. That day when I left the Capitol driving home, now I make a living about how many people, about putting people's asses in the seat. You did. So I went through my thing as I was sitting there on stage with Million Man March, and I did certain quadrants. And I would do like, okay, it's 200,000 people here, it's 200,000 people here, it's 200,000, so on and so forth. I had 8 of those quadrants, which equaled up to about 1,600,000 people. Now, I may well have been off by a full quadrant. Let's say I was off by 2. That's still well over 1 million people. So when I get in the car and hear the first report about the number of people, they said it was approximately 400,000. I was like, these bastards are rewriting history on the spot. They're telling his story, not history, on the spot. They're trying to retell the greatness and make it less than. That's what
and to this day, the National Park Service no longer gives crowd estimates.
Man.
To this day.
Let me tell you.
To this day.
You know,
so that's why it's
that's a part of how our narrative has been told. It's a part of how I've been trying to change.
Well, let's get into Tony Browder, who has dedicated his life in changing that narrative. He talks here about the institution of white supremacy.
What a brilliant brother.
Chili Bowl. Yes, sir. My aunt had a jewelry store there. So I came up to visit my aunt and I was able to see my first movie. It was called Tarzan Comes to New York, or Goes to New York.
Right.
When you talk about a false narrative and you talk about speculative architectonics, how does that kind of cultural piece play in hiding the reality of who a people really are?
Right. Very simple. Edgar Rice Burroughs was the author of Tarzan novels. Tarzan is a white man who is stranded in the jungle as a child. He grows up to become the king of the jungle. All right. So this idea of white people being the master of their domain, wherever they are, is a false narrative that creates within the minds of white people this false sense of superiority, and in the minds of black people who buy into this false narrative that white people are superior and we are inferior, hence the beginning of this brainwashing that results in us hating ourselves and disrespecting ourselves. So I'm all about destroying the negatives, destroying the negative stereotypes, the narrative, and the destruction of those narratives can always be done through historical research, empirical research, and truth. So.
And to the 60-year-old silver-haired, beautiful white lady that is sitting out there that just loves everybody.
Yes.
She might say you're practicing black supremacy.
No. What I'm dealing with is putting history in a timeline. If we go back to the Blasio mural, that begins with the written record. The written record began in Africa. Humanity began in Africa. The oldest documented culture and civilization began in Africa. So I'm going to the beginning. It has nothing to do with superiority and inferiority. It has everything to do with constructing the narrative in its proper chronological sequence. So that's why timelines are so important. So if we were to look at a timeline of Kemet or ancient Egypt, we see that that civilization began around 3200 BC and that there were 4 ages of great development, and that around 856 BC, Greece became a nation state, And around 730, Rome became a nation state. So Greece and Rome are the foundation of European history and culture, mm-hmm. but African culture and civilization preceded it by over 2,000 years. That has nothing to do with racism. That is a correct historical perspective. Mm-hmm. And so Greece conquered Egypt in 332. Mm-hmm. And Greeks ruled Egypt for approximately...
Greece conquered Egypt in 332.
Right, B.C.
B.C. At the time, the name was Kemet.
Exactly.
They conquered Kemet and named it Egypt.
It named it Egypt.
Right.
And that's very important because Egypt is a Greek word. Pyramid is a Greek word. Sphinx is a Greek word. Mm-hmm. So many of the terms that we use to describe African people, places, and things are European terms.
And that was the intelligent historian, Egypt on Potomac himself, Tony Browder, breaking down the tenements of white supremacy. Rock, you got any quick comment on that? Dr. Tony Browder, we like to call him Dr.
Tony Browder is unquestionably a jewel man, and he calls himself, he describes himself as a sort of having people to unremember what they think they already know. And he does it with invaluable, unquestionable facts to point out how the Washington Monument was taken from ancient Egypt and so much more. His contribution, you know, to our living and to our understanding of who we really are is invaluable.
Real quick, and I did not know Egypt was a Greek word. The Tekken is a Greek word for the Washington Monument. The word Sphinx is a Greek word. And so even in our acknowledgments of our greatness and accomplishments, we're using the framework of the conqueror.
That's right.
Avis?
Well, I wanted to add that Tony Browder has been on the show the most. We've had him on several times, and he's, you know, powerful, you know, commentary about the things that's going on in Egypt. He's been there over 50 times. It's a work that he's dedicated his life to, and you know, it just and that's someone you can still support today. I mean, he's still active. A lot of these people, you know, and that's a good thing. But a lot of these people are still very active, and Tony Browder is still out there doing his thing. I mean. Great work. And he breaks it down historically. Like you said, this is not about race. It's just historically. It lets us know, you know, it tells you, like we say, he's about memory recovery. It lets you understand that
we did
things first.
Yeah. It's hard to continue to envision a blonde-haired, blue-eyed Jesus after you listen to Tony Browder give you the real facts. Jesus was a black man.
And if you're going by their own book, it says hair like lamb, wool, feet like brass, burnt brass. I don't know
like
what
the debate is about. That's right.
let's go there. We're going to Dick Gregory now. He talks about Malcolm X. When we come back, Rock, I want you to talk something about your relationship with Baba Dick Gregory.
Okay.
During the same time, died 3 years before Martin Luther King did, Malcolm X.
Yes.
I remember you saying one time, just in a conversation, I'm sitting there hearing you talk,
yes.
and mm-hmm. you talked about him, and you talked about his laugh. You talked about how funny he was.
Funny, 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 funny. Him and Richard Pryor had two things in common. And I'm not talking about funny.
Yeah.
They were so bashful, you'd be uncomfortable.
Mm.
Mm.
Yeah.
Was the most to sit with Richard Pryor. I couldn't sit with Richard Pryor longer than 15 minutes.
Uh-huh.
He looked down.
Yeah.
When that camera come on.
Yeah.
And Malcolm was the same way.
Really?
Malcolm sold me some Wolf tickets. I'm playing the Basin Street East in New York. The phone rings. Dick Gregory, Brother Malcolm. Hey, champ, what's happening? Said, when you gonna come down to the mosque? I said, well, what time is it? He said, 11:30. I said, well, send a car out here. I'll be ready at noon. Now, here's the real Malcolm. So Malcolm said, I'll call you back. And Malcolm called back. He said, man, you can't come out to the mosque. 99% of your audience is white folks. I said, did you call me?
Yeah.
Huh? Yeah. Huh? You call me, I'm enjoying myself. Got me a little whiskey over here. And, you know, eat me some pork chops. You understand? And you interrupt my and tell me I can't come. Well, let me put it like this here. You send a car for me and pick me up. And we're going to take a picture, you and I, standing in front of the mosque, holding Muhammad Speaks, and I want to see it on the cover of the newspaper. That was our introduction.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. No bean pies involved?
No, they cook some bean pies. Yeah, the bean pies are a little mysterious.
And that was Baba Dick Gregory, the late, great Dick Gregory, humanitarian and activist. And sometimes comedian. He knew Malcolm X, as he alluded to, Martin Luther King. He knew Mega Evers. He knew Muhammad Ali. He knew Bob Marley. And while I was off air, I just found out he also knew John Lennon, my favorite Beatle, and Yoko Ono. Rock, give us something about Baba Dick Gregory.
My God. I probably would start with one of the most fearless men I knew. He truly epitomized, believed, and was a living example of that God and fear can't live in the same place.
Yeah.
And he always chose God, no matter the circumstances. And so whenever it was a cause that people were afraid to embrace, whether it was Wounded Knee, whether it was in Birmingham, no matter where it was, I traveled. As a matter of fact, I advanced the trip that he took to Tehran while the hostages were being kept there. He came over on a humanitarian, effort. He ended up meeting with the Ayatollah. Let me say something that might sound like hyperbole. The day that the helicopter crash took place there in Tehran when they were trying to rescue some of the hostages, that was the day that that Dick was supposed to meet with Hosfadeh and the Ayatollah. The plan was going to be for a couple of the hostages to be released as a good faith gesture by the Iranians. The goddamn helicopter crash came and it caused that meeting to be canceled. But the Ayatollah, who Mike Wallace from 60 Minutes said was one of the most brilliant human beings he had ever met, granted, they set up 10, 15 minutes for Greg to meet with the Ayatollah, and they spent hours together. One of the most fearless humans on the planet, and Lord knows, one of the funniest.
All right, and we're going to keep it moving. Rest in peace, Baba Dick Gregory. And let's talk about another giant that we lost, Dr. Sabi.
Opening of this show, I talked about you having worked with Michael Jackson.
Yes.
Can you tell us about how that came about and what kind of work you did with him?
I was home a Sunday afternoon in Los Angeles on La Cienega. Somebody threw a rock at my window. When I looked outside, it was Randy. Well, I had known Randy over the years, Randy Jackson.
Yes.
Michael Jackson brother.
Mm-hmm.
So he came upstairs. What's it? My brother want to see you. I said, who? Michael. Michael? Michael want to see me? I'm the least of the individual that people want to see. I'm at the bottom of the totem pole. Mm-hmm. I went to see him. And he said he was in agreement with me traveling with him. And I told him that I would be able to help him. Yeah. He couldn't sleep. He was in a very bad emotional state.
What time frame, what time period was this? Do you remember?
2004.
Okay.
I was with him from February until September.
Of 2004.
At the ending of September, I told him, I said, you know, you're singing, you feel good, you're looking good, I'm leaving. He said, don't leave me. I said, why? He said, I want you by my side, but I have a business to build. But I love Michael. Michael, beautiful.
Yeah.
Beautiful brother.
What did you do for him?
What I did for him was this. I gave Michael an intracellular chelation. An intracellular chelation means that I'm going to clean every cell that makes up every organ that totals his biological structure. Because he was full of a whole of drugs, you know, the pharmaceutical drugs.
Yeah.
Couldn't sleep.
Yeah.
His nerve was shattered. So I began treating him.
Yeah.
And at the ending of the period, he was doing good and I left.
Yeah.
And that's Dr. Sabe. Nipsey, the late great Nipsey Hussle, is going to do a documentary on Dr. Sabe. Because for those who don't know, Dr. Sabe was actually in prison for practicing medicine without a license. He claimed he had a cure for AIDS. And he went to court, federal court in New York, and won his case, proving that he did treat AIDS patients successfully. And
not just AIDS, but diabetes. Cancer. And the judge told him that he defended himself, as you said. The judge told him that he had to bring one cured person, but he just couldn't bring somebody that he said he was cured. They needed to have someone that diagnosed them with cancer, and then who diagnosed that they no longer had cancer, that they were cancer free. Said you got to bring one from each category. It was seven categories. He brought seven people who he had treated, who had been diagnosed with a fatal disease, and all of them had been cured. The judge let him out of jail and let him go free.
There you have it. There you have it. Medical apartheid system. Dr. Sabe was challenging it. I urge everybody to learn more about that case, because I think we need to revisit that now, since we have this pandemic right now, Brother Rock. I think it'd be timely to revisit that case, and let's start debating some of those issues, because I didn't know it was seven. I thought it was just AIDS.
Yeah, and I'm going to tell you something. I believe that he died of natural causes, as they have tried to say. Just like Fred Hampton died of natural causes that came from the bullets of the Chicago police and the FBI. Dr. Sabe was getting ready to have a dramatic impact on the drug, on the food and drug universe. And you know, he came up dead, they said, from pneumonia. Here's a man who, the number one thing that he will tell you about health is keeping mucus out of your body. And they're going to say he died of pneumonia. I don't buy that.
You heard it here first, ladies and gentlemen. Heard it here first. Definitely do your research on Dr. Sabe. And another iconoclastic teacher is Jane Elliott, who is an ally of our struggle and in disseminating or dismantling, rather, white supremacy, and also in her expertise in education. This is Jane Elliott. We go to her now.
Tell me about your activity in the school. Did you do any sort of racial justice kind of stuff, fighting white supremacy, before the Martin Luther King incident?
Martin Luther King was one of our heroes of the month in February. Every year,
mm-hmm.
along with, unfortunately, George Washington, who owned slaves, bought and sold people for money,
mm-hmm.
Abraham Lincoln, who refused to free the slaves,
mm-hmm.
Davy Crockett, who died while he was killing off Mexicans while we tried to take over part of their land.
Mm-hmm.
That was racist teaching. I would not have accused myself of teaching racism, but I did. Mm-hmm. That was the curriculum that you taught.
Mm-hmm.
I taught the curriculum.
Mm-hmm.
So what I was doing was not educating, I was indoctrinating.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we do in the schools in this country. We call it education, but we indoctrinate students. We teach them how to be good Americans. We teach them a lie in order to guarantee that they're going to be good Americans. And they believe the lie.
What's the lie?
The lie is the superiority of white people. It's a lie. It's a flat-out lie. I thought we had stopped until I talked to my seventh-grade granddaughter in Washington State a year ago. They were learning about the Williams Massacre, in which, as she explained it to me, a group of Indians killed a white missionary. I said, is your teacher going to tell you about the Mountain Meadow Massacre? She said, what's the Mountain Meadow Massacre? I said, it's when the Mormons sent a group of Mormons out to kill all the members of a wagon train that were coming through Utah. They killed every member of that, except one young girl, I think, survived. The soldiers went out, found this wagon train with all these dead people, knew that the Indians hadn't done it, talked to the Mormons, and they said, yes, we did it. I said, ask your teacher if he's going to tell you about the Mountain Meadow Massacre. She called me the next week and said, Grammy, you got me in a lot of trouble. I said, what happened? She said, I raised my hand and asked if we're going to learn about the Mountain Meadow Massacre, and the teacher took me out in the hall and said, Grace, we don't talk about that in this school. I can't teach you that, because if I did, you wouldn't be a good American. You wouldn't love America anymore. I went ballistic. This is not teaching. This is not education. The word education, to educate someone means to be in the act of leading them out of ignorance. You don't do that by indoctrinating them. That child was being indoctrinated.
And that was Jane Elliott talking about white supremacy in education. When we're teaching the babies that Christopher Columbus discovered America with people already there is the cornerstone of white supremacy in education. She goes on to say that prejudice is a sincere commitment to ignorance. What say you, Brother Rock?
An emotional commitment to ignorance. That's exactly right. It is a form of insanity because you know better. They know better, but they have to pretend. They have to hold on to something that is false to make themselves feel superior, because they know in reality it is not true. So that hurt when she coined that phrase, man, that was point on. And racism is an emotional commitment to ignorance. If you are a racist, the base of your reasoning comes from ignorance.
There you have it. Avis, you got something to say about Jane Elliott?
I think Jane Elliott, you know, that was another amazing interview. I think she kind of lets you know that the subtle racism is probably, you know, is the worst racism, you know, and that's why she does it with the regular rank and file people, you know, that was where they're not. But she'll show, you know, for racism to continue and to thrive, you need that, those subtle racists who will just turn their heads or think they dipping their feet into it, but you get these big time, you know, you get the things that people can do. Like you see those big those pictures of where all, you know, they may hang somebody, but the whole town is right there. So then, you know, that's that subtle racism that's supporting them doing what they're doing. And this thing keeps on, you know, continues to thrive. And she works with people to bring that out, you know, in her meetings that she do with the Blue Eye, I forgot the name of it, her Blue Eye thing.
Well, Lyndon B. Johnson famously said that if you can convince the lowest white man that he's better than the best black man, that he won't notice that you pick in his pockets. He said, hell, you give him someone to look down on, he'll empty his pockets for you.
That's right.
And that is the cult, you know, following that white supremacy has, and they're clinging to it. And we've seen it in January 6th, they're clinging to it, you know? And so we live in exciting times, and we hope to see the continuing dismantling of white supremacy, but it's leashing out, fighting for survival. And as a wounded animal, I think is even more dangerous today than it was ever before. You had a program, Rock, on Jimmy Gardner, who was exonerated after 26 years being in prison. For a crime that he didn't commit. That's 1 year short of Nelson Mandela's time in prison unjustly. Let's go to that now and get your feelings on that Jimmy Gardner's testimony to his strength and what sustained him during that time in prison.
I'm going to ask you, when did the reality of you've been sentenced to 110 years, when did that set in? Did you ever accept
never
that this was going to be your fate, you're going to be in jail the rest of your life?
Never. And that's a key point. That number that the judge gave me could have been a million years.
Right.
It wouldn't have made a difference.
What do you mean by that?
I mean, whatever number that he would have came out of his mouth and said, this is what we're sentencing you to.
Yeah.
And in my mind, all I'm going to do is fight for my life, whether it's life without 200 or 300 years, makes yeah. no difference.
Yeah.
I know I'm in a fight for my life, and that's all I'm focusing on. Mm-hmm. I mentally blocked out the number of years, the conviction,
yeah.
except for me fighting for my life.
Right.
And I mean it's a different level of going through the mental. Uh-huh. You know, I read all type of powerful books, yeah. and I went to another level myself, reading mm-hmm. Dr. Viktor Frankl, Man's Search for Meaning, you know, As a Man Thinking by James Allen, some powerful mm-hmm. thinking books.
Uh-huh.
You know, and
so you had to get into a space.
Yes, I did.
Where it was non-existent what the judge
made no difference
had put upon you.
Made no difference.
Your existence was an existence.
That's right.
Not thinking about how long you had to serve.
No.
Just focusing every day, all the time.
On what I got to do to get out of
there. On what you have to do to get out. Okay, now, so you're there. Mm-hmm. You think that's your mindset.
That's my mindset.
But nevertheless,
yes,
you are captive. You're captive.
Physically.
Physically.
That's it.
Mm-hmm. In West Virginia, and you have to abide by rules and regulations
right.
of the penal system.
Mm-hmm. And that was Jimmy Gardner, exonerated after 26 years, unjustly incarcerated, talking about mind power. What do you have to say about mind power, Brother Rock?
You know, I would probably quickly say that he was there as a result of demonic behavior by the state, by a representative of the state, planted all this false information. And while he was there, it came to light through the penal system and in the justice system that this information had been planted wrongfully by someone who had left West Virginia and gone to Texas and done the same damn thing. Yet the justice system treated this black man like he was guilty for decades when they knew he was innocent. So therefore, it's not a justice system when it comes to black people. It's an injustice system, and we need to recognize that. To think of that guy's talk about mind power, he was sent to solitary confinement. He was in prison in solitary confinement with a window blown out 10 feet above his head while it was snowing and 8 degrees for a couple of days. The only way he could use the toilet was to take the plunger, take the top, the wood part of the plunger and break the ice. He sat in that cell. The only thing he could hear was his teeth chatter. Still, he rose. He came out, and I don't know if you know this part of the story. He was finally exonerated, proven to be innocent. He came out, and after a year or so of advocating for the release of other innocent people, he married Stacey Abrams' sister, who's the federal judge in Atlanta.
Wow.
That's right.
He's married up.
He married up.
Well, you know, there's so many cases like that, and thank you for highlighting that. Real quick, Johnny Cochran, another talent figure, the late great Johnny Cochran, I had the pleasure of getting to know as well. He said that his greatest case wasn't OJ. It was Geronimo Pratt, a high-ranking member from the Black Panther Party, who also was framed and was exonerated after doing 26, 27 years in prison. And the FBI set him up because he was on FBI surveillance tapes, the COINTELPRO J. Edgar Hoover tapes, proving he was hundreds of miles away from the murder they pinned on him.
Yep.
So they knew going in that he was innocent. And they withheld the information to get the conviction. This is the American injustice system. You know, this is Black History Month, Rock Newman Tribute, Truth Telling, The Lying Stories.
It's more than a little silly cliche, what my friend Don Hubbard in New Orleans says so often. Life ain't easy when you're black and greasy.
Ain't been no crystal skin either. All right, back to the storytelling. We're going to go to the Fine family who rock. How many Oscars the Fine family have? How many Emmys? They have a couple of Oscars. They got some of them.
I think it's 88 Emmys and 2 Oscars.
Here we go. Emmy and an Oscar award-winning Fine family.
We have folks that were so patient to stay with us. Our guest, what would have been the 9 o'clock hour, is Sean and Andrea Fine, winner of this year's Academy Award. You see these Oscars right here? They won these. They're the best in their business, in their category. So I have Sean and Andrea to my left, and to the right, I have their mama and daddy, Paul Fine and Holly Fine. No slouches of their own in the film world. They have, between them, 85 Emmys. How about a hand from the studio audience for this, for our absolutely great guest. We call this hour the Mighty Fine Hour. Vince Gray, the mayor, texted me right here and said to make sure that I tell them that he thinks it's a fine idea that they're in the studios on Martin Luther King Avenue and that they truly are rock stars. Let me do it again and welcome Sean, Andrea, Holly, and Paul.
And that was a fine clip from the Fine family. Avis, rock, the floor is yours.
Go for it, Avis.
Well, I don't know. You know, the Fine family was an amazing experience. It was definitely was at WEAC Radio Studios. They're you know, television and multimedia royalty. You know what they say, 85 Emmys. I remember Mr. Paul Fine talking about, you know, his experiences with the many personalities that he got a chance to meet. And then his son, the day after winning the Oscar, the day after seeing them, I don't even think it was 24 hours, the day after seeing them, you know, the Oscars are right there in WEAC Studios with us and Mr. and Mrs. Fine. I mean, so all together was 2 Emmys and 85 Oscars.
It was the other way around. 85 Emmys that they were responsible for and the 2 Oscars.
Yeah, right, the other way around.
Yeah, that was we love them. And you know, the relationship there has been longstanding. Paul and Holly Fine were the producers for 60 Minutes and Mike Wallace that did the piece on me back in 1992. And, you know, there needed to be a real transparency. And we gave that to them. We gave them transparency. We gave them honest. We did what we said we were going to do. And, you know, it ended up being one of 60 Minutes' positive pieces because, you know, 60 Minutes is cut your throat.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. This one is a somber clip. We're talking about a father's loss of a child. Rock, the sister's name was Lavina Johnson?
Yes.
Let's go to the father of Lavina Johnson now and talk about his loss.
She actually was murdered the same night that we talked to her, and that was the 17th of July in 2005. The Army came to my house on the 19th and said she died of a self-inflicted wound. They didn't tell me how. I did a preliminary investigation and I found out she had been shot in the head.
Okay. You get a knock on the door. I mean, right. This is obviously something that military families, this is the most dreaded.
Yeah. God.
of events.
Yeah.
Who's there? You and your wife? Or?
We were in the bed. It was 7:30 in the morning. We got the doorbell rang. I jumped up and I was wondering, I wonder who's coming here this time of the day. My wife looked out the window and she said, oh, John, there's a soldier on the porch. And I thought, oh, man. So she said, what does that mean? I said, something happened to Lavina. So I come down the stairs and I open the door and I'm expecting to see a chaplain or an officer or somebody like that. It was a staff sergeant. So I immediately thought, well, then it must not be that bad. Mm-hmm. But then he said, are you Mr. John Johnson, father of Lavina L. Johnson? And I said, yeah. He said, is your wife here? My wife was standing up on the balcony of our home. She said, what do you want? He stepped in my foyer. He said, I have a message from the Secretary of Defense. This morning, Lavina L. Johnson died of self-inflicted wounds. I'm standing there looking at this man. I was totally shocked. I fell back on the steps, but thank God that lasted about 5 minutes. He stood there stoic the whole time just looking at me. So I said,
What reaction did your wife have?
My wife collapsed. It was the bellying and the grieving. It was so horrible. Woke up all the kids. My sons, they live in the basement. They ran up the steps. My oldest boy ran to me. The one next to him ran up on the balcony, so they were trying to come. She was just, somebody done killed my baby. Somebody done killed me.
And that was a father's loss. Yet another Sandra Bland-style story. And we need to understand that there's a poster on the front door of We Act Radio in Anacostia from the late, great anti-lynching activist Ida B. Wells. And she says that those that commit the murders write the reports. Rock, your response to Lavina Johnson's father.
Well, needless to say, man, that was a painful interview to do. He was then and is still committed to trying to have that wrong righted. They're still working on it. A gentleman, one of the military people, had been identified and accused of being the murderer. Now, if I'm ever accused of being a murderer, I'm going to raise hell and I'm going to sue the people that's accusing me to do that. He has not done so. So that case is still out there. And I'm very interested in what the final outcome is going to be.
Okay. And staying on that somber note, our last clip today is Miss, is it Lonice Byers?
Lonice. Yeah.
She's the mother of the late, great Lynn Byers. For those who are in the D.C. or not in the D.C. area, Lynn Byers was a star athlete out of University of Maryland. And he was a star basketball player at a Michael Jordan level style of greatness, and was just signed. He was drafted by the Boston Celtics.
Number one
draft pick. Wow. And was lost to a cocaine overdose, and they used him as a marketing post for a lot of draconian drug laws that came after. And it's important to point out that Miss Lonice didn't just lose one son, she lost two.
Yeah.
Let's go to the mother of Lynn Byers now.
So now Lynn has this superstar career, as I just mentioned, you know, all of those, mm-hmm. all of those accolades, so much of a career that the storied franchise, one of the most storied franchises in the NBA, led by Red Auerbach, who said to many that he had been looking at Lynn Byers for many years and that he wanted your son to be drafted and to become a Celtic and to become the face of that franchise. He basically saw him as a savior. Mm-hmm. So they draft him with the first pick, with the first pick in 1986. We're talking almost 30 years ago, but it's still a whole lot of money and all the endorsements and everything else. The wonderful, fantastic, incredible news. Yeah. Mm-hmm. First, tell us how you felt about those happy moments.
If I could be just honest about it, as I had said in interviews years ago, is that even though I could see the gold ring, I could never envision him touching it. Do you understand what I'm saying?
No.
It was like everyone is saying, oh, look, 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 look what Lenny's about to do. Look, look, look. But in my heart of hearts, I never felt it. I never saw it.
Why?
It was just something there within me that I was hoping and praying. I'm a woman of faith that it would happen, but it was something in me.
So he gets drafted, the greatest news, you know, mm-hmm. in an athlete's life.
If yeah.
you go to the Boston Celtics, he's the number two pick.
Yeah.
Many argue he should have been the number one.
Yeah.
And again, as I said, I just want to understand, as you, that was so much gold, sort of, there's the rainbow, and now
yes.
it's right within
yes.
grasp. Everyone saw that and felt it was imminent,
yes.
but you didn't feel it was going to materialize.
It wasn't that I didn't feel that it wasn't going to materialize. It was I had a wait and see attitude if it would happen,
right.
if you can understand what I'm saying.
Okay.
It wasn't that I was saying, oh, that's not going to happen, or I'm there with my family. We're all cheering. We're all hoping. But as a mother, inside of me, this isn't anything that I was going around telling people, oh, I don't think it's going to happen. I'm sharing with you what was on the inside of me.
Yeah.
At that time, it was like, I can remember being in the hair salon one day, and the hairstylist was saying, oh, this is going to happen, that's going to happen. And I said, but let me explain to you what I see. I said, it's, you see that table there? It looks like I'm going to go over and touch it. But until I touch it, I have not touched it. And that's the way I am okay. with Len. I don't know. And then people, you know, she said, oh, you're silly. What are you talking about? Yeah. But I knew what I felt in my heart.
That definitely should have been an Emmy nominated, a worthy episode of the Rock Newman Show, having Len Bias' mom, Miss Lanice Bias, on the show. Rock, what was your memories from that program with her?
And you see, right now I have this mask on that says Black Women Rock. She was an example of that in terms of the strength that she had to demonstrate and the resilience that she had to demonstrate to carry on, just losing her two boys in their early years. The euphoria of the high of Len Bias being drafted number one to the bottomless pit of despair and grief of him dying senselessly of an overdose, and her having to endure that, come back. And then for her to take that grief and channel it into making herself better, educating herself, so then she could have an impact on others. What a champion she was. And I feel right now, and I hear right now, the deafening silence in the studio when the show was over. Proverbial, using that proverbial term, you could hear a pin drop. Oh no, you could hear hair drop on the floor. Everybody within the sound of her voice was still and quiet with reverence. And I still feel that way about her.
Wow. My father said, you can hear a mouse pissing on cotton.
That's right.
Avis?
I'm totally in agreement with Rock. That show was, I believe a few people were crying. I mean, you know, that show was unbelievable. And just the amount of strength that she displayed and composure was unbelievable. I mean, you know, you're talking to a woman whose son was the rival of Michael Jordan. You know what I mean? And just see all that slip away. You know, just how many reminders she get of, you know, that she has of that every time a bill comes through or something like that, you know, where she, the life that was just right there, you know, and it just slipped away and off, you know, off stage, off the show. She had said, you know, her theme is pretty much watch your associations. And I think anybody who has any desire to get into the fame game, be it through sports or entertainment, I think they all should definitely pay heed to Ms. Lennon Bias' show and, you know, the things that she was saying about what happened with her and her sons.
The Rock Newman Show tribute right here, ladies and gentlemen. They have produced upwards of 200 programs. Avis J, seen here, is responsible for a good portion of those guests being on. Avis, you want to talk about some of your experience in wrangling guests on the Rock Newman Show before we get out of here?
No, you know what? This is a show dedicated to the big brother, Rock Newman. Let me tell you, it's been an amazing experience. I've been with Rock Newman and he stuck with me and, you know, through, you know, giants of, you know, of industry to billionaires. And he's been like, hey, this is my man Avis, you know? So, you know, it's been an extraordinary journey. I mean, he's had the uncanny mastery of being able to walk that tightrope between these two different worlds. I mean, I've been with him and on that side of the fence, but then me and Rock's been there and I've carried food with him and we fed the homeless. And when we were there with the homeless, they all, you know, acknowledged him, hey Rock. And it was no craziness, it was no super fanfare. It was just like they were seeing an old friend. You know what I mean? And that's the way he carried himself. I mean, and that's a brother, just like what Ozzy, what the brother said about Malcolm. Have you ever walked with Rock and talked with him? And, you know, so it's been a great experience. I mean, there's no way I can pay him back.
So Rock, you heard it here. You know, you got upwards of 200 programs. Avis did his thing and helped wrangling some of his guests. But as you said before, you know, you just opened up your Rolodex because you have been a very accomplished man in your life. You've had so many successes. But oftentimes when we share the stories of our successes only, thinking we're inspiring those who are partaking of that story, we think we're inspiring them, but sometimes it's the direct opposite. We're discouraging them because by only showing our success, it intimidates those who experience failure. If you could you share a story where you may have failed and how you was able to move past that?
That might be the toughest question you've asked all day. You know,
we act radio, do something.
That's right, that's it, that's exactly right. You know, come on, I think how I would respond to that is that there was a period in my life, I'm gonna say what was my mid to late 20s, where I was about the business of chasing whatever I was chasing from an entrepreneurial point of view so I could make some money. I was chasing money. I was the things that I was doing, the pursuits that I was taking. It was after money, dollar sign was the big thing that I had in my head. And I read Think and Grow Rich. And once I did that, I also started to get into some other type books that would talk about putting your purpose first, your intent. So those things that I sought out, that I sought to do to make money, that really didn't pan out, was that was the, you know, at some point it was like, okay, when you put your good intentions out into the universe and lead with that, the universe will open up paths for your success, where if you're only chasing money, you kind of got to do it all on your own. I remember going to bed a number of times fighting a corrupt industry, the boxing industry, when I was trying to take Riddick Bowe through the ranks. I started his career. The first press conference we had, I said, I want our example to be an example of how an athlete should be treated by the person that represents him. And that I would be disappointed if he just became the heavyweight champion of the world in boxing. That I wanted him to be an example, and I wanted us to be an example to make a positive impact on the world. At 3 o'clock in the morning, I hadn't figured out what my next move should be. I felt defeated and that I might have lost the battle that I was pursuing there. But because my intentions were pure, they were good, they were noble, they were for the greater good. When I would wake up the next morning, there would be a series of occurrences that would have happened that generated for me something greater than I was pursuing when I went to bed that night. So there have been many little failures. There have been many little losses. But I think when your intention is right and you're on purpose, the universe has a way to keep lifting you and giving you what you dreamed of and oftentimes beyond. Because I can tell you, I never dreamed of having the life that I have, that this life that I have had. And I don't take it lightly. I'm always humble about it because it wasn't just me. There was a divine force that has been in play here that has blessed me beyond my worthiness. I think I'll wrap it there.
And ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, the great Rock Newman, as you just said, put your purpose first and lead with intention.
Good.
That's what we're here to do. That's what we're here to do. Yeah. So, Avis, if you would join me in saluting Brother Rock Newman.
Oh, absolutely.
Right back. Boom. Love you guys, man.
Happy birthday. Many more. Enjoy all your trips around the sun, no matter what. We hope to hear more from you in the years to come. And hopefully the Rock Newman Show, those cans that you, the shows that are in the can will continue to be put out into the sun and can grow and flourish, because I think they are all timeless capsules of our storytelling and a testimony to one of the crown jewels of the Rock Newman Industries.
Let me say to you, there's more to come.
And more to come. The story ain't over. The story ain't over. All right. That's our time here, boys and girls. Avis, you want to pull them on? They can go to subscribe to Rock Newman YouTube channel to see a litany of those programs continuously.
Yes, sir. Definitely all the shows up on the Rock Newman Show. We had a couple of shows I think you have a couple of shows on We Act channel also.
Well, we have a few that was done in We Act studios, and my YouTube on We Act Radio and Rock Newman's YouTube channels are the ones that people should subscribe to get all the previous programs. So having said that, thank you, Brother Rock. Happy birthday. Bless you and your family. Thank you, Avis J, for making it work and being the bridge between the two of us. And thank you to our staff and our broadcast engineer, Bradley Herring, on the ones and twos. And this has been Pappy Kimone Freeman, Angry Black Man in Therapy, telling you all in the sound of my voice, whatever you do, do something. Stay safe, stay strong, stay woke. Peace, y'all.
Out to the peace.
Coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show.